We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Joanne Lamont.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what engagements is planned for the rest of the day.
Well, today we've launched the fantastic news that Lanarkshire Life Sciences Facility BioCity Scotland, together with Scottish Universities Life Science Alliance and the University of Dundee, have won a £100 million drug discovery contract. It means immediately 40 highly skilled jobs in Newhouse, with the promise of many more developments to come. It puts Scotland at the very centre of European drug discovery, and I know it will be welcomed by the whole Chamber.
Joanne Lamont.
Indeed. Yesterday morning, the First Minister visited technology company Clyde Space in Glasgow, where he said, "This is one small satellite for Clyde and a giant leap for their extraterrestrial export business." In the afternoon, his backbenchers applauded a £24 million cut in college budgets. Does the First Minister feel he and his party are in touch with real Scots?
First Minister?
Yes.
Joanne Lamont?
Scotland needs jobs. Last year, the Scottish Government said they would spend £353 million on shovel-ready capital projects. In reality, they spent just £20 million. Of the £119 million they said they would spend on new schools, they have spent nothing, not one coin. On Monday, however, the Deputy First Minister said that within 15 months of the referendum, we could be like Namibia or Togo. Does the First Minister feel he is in touch with the real priorities of Scots?
First Minister.
The capital budget, the direct capital budget, the one that you fund shovel-ready projects from on, has been cut by 26% by the Westminster Government. The Westminster Government's defence of that was it was better than the 35%. Which was the projected cut of Alistair Darling, the man who wanted to implement cuts which were, quote, deeper and tougher than those of Margaret Thatcher. The great advantage of direct capital spending by government is it can be spent on shovel-ready projects and it can be spent quickly. The fact that Joanne Lamont doesn't know the difference between direct government spending and the non-profit distribution trust is a signal feature of the Labour Party's inability to understand the basics of public finance. NPD funding is project-based. You have to build the project and you have to gather in the finance. The great virtue of NPD is that it's a lot cheaper than PFI. The reason we introduced the NPD programme is because we didn't want ever again to see the Scottish people play out billions of pounds over the next 30 years in private finance initiative projects which will result in payments of many, many times their capital value. And the fact that even the Conservative Party now admits that PFI was a ghastly mistake exposes the Better Together campaign as two right-wing parties competing for which one could be the more extreme.
Joanne Lamont. Order.
Even I, in my least charitable moments, did not imagine that the First Minister planned not to spend any money in the NPD programme on schools. And it's not that I don't understand the project. It is that the First Minister said we'll spend £119 million and he's not spent one coin. And those jobs have not come. The complacency is astonishing, so I'm going to ask the First Minister to come back with us to the real world. For this morning, we spoke to Anne Fisher, who is a 50-year-old mother of three. She has cancer. She lives in Greenock. If she lived in England, she would be receiving drugs which could prolong her life. Because she lives in Scotland, she doesn't get that treatment. The government's delayed review of drugs will be too late for Anne. And her case is sadly not an isolated one. So, while Anne fights for treatment, the former Health Secretary, Nicola Sturgeon, had time this week to publish the words of Abraham Lincoln, apparently on a written constitution. Does the First Minister believe that he and his government are in touch with the real needs of people like Anne Fisher?
First Minister.
The whole area of access to drug treatment is an extremely serious one. It's something that should, in this chamber, be treated as that. The Labour Party will remember that they agreed with us in not going down the road of a cancer drugs fund, agreed with many of the cancer charities on that aspect. They also welcomed the introduction recently of the Rare Conditions Medicine Fund by the Health Secretary. And I think, you know, it should be accepted that in trying to deal with these extraordinarily difficult issues, we're trying to find the best system possible, which allows our people to have access to the best possible treatment. But the idea that these issues are easy to deal with is not extraordinary, that you can wave them away. It's one of the great challenges facing health services across the world. And the combination that we've tried to arrive at in Scotland through the Scottish Medicines Consortium, the introduction of the new fund looking at rare conditions, and the individual patient requests, is, we believe, the best possible system we can have at the present moment as we move to the new drug pricing system. And I would hope that, you know, whatever people's views across the chamber, would recognise that this government, like all parties across the chamber, are trying to deal with that issue in the best possible way to help the most number of people.
Joanne Lamont.
I can assure you I do take this issue extremely seriously. What I ask the government to do is to listen to what people are saying to them and act. And the problem has been that this issue, it has taken newspaper headlines to get Alec Neil to act. And I think that is a problem. And even now, what the First Minister says does not address the problems of Anne Fisher. And I would ask him again to look at that. But whatever the First Minister is doing, what he is certainly not doing is addressing the real needs of Scots. He'd rather play games of imagining where he might be in 3 years' time than face the reality of today. And while he pretends the needs of Scots seeking jobs are ignored, patients like Anne Fisher go untreated, students miss out on a college education, and the First Minister prepares the seating plan for our independence ball. The First Minister even seems to have given up on trying to make the case for independence and instead is trying to persuade Scots they've already voted for it. When will the First Minister start addressing the real needs of Scots rather than his own game of let's pretend?
First Minister, order.
Joanne Lamont, that the Labour Party voted with the government on the question of the Cancer Drugs Fund, and secondly, that Alec Neil, as Health Secretary, took the advice that was coming forward instead in setting up the Rare Conditions Medicine Fund. And of course, the Routledge Review, again, is looking at this very issue to make sure we can have the best possible system in Scotland. That indicates to me that we are taking things extremely seriously as far as that's concerned, as every member should. This government's commitment to the National Health Service, in my view, is beyond argument. Yeah. We are the party who, in two successive elections, promised to increase funding to the National Health Service. Joanne Lamont leads a party which, in two successive elections, would not give that commitment. Therefore, the issue of the National Health Service, which, like all public services, is under great pressure at the present moment, it should be remembered that it's because of this government's success in being re-elected that the National Health Service revenue budget is increasing in real terms. There will be no guarantee from anyone else. The difficulty of the Labour Party in making political points about the National Health Service was well exemplified only yesterday by the extraordinary and dreadful revelations about Mid Staffordshire a Hospital Foundation Trust. It is a point that occurred not when Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister, not when this Tory Liberal coalition was Prime Minister, but under Labour's watch. Yeah. And what happened, according to page 19 of the report, was that management thinking during the period under review was dominated by financial pressures and achieving foundation trust status to the detriment of quality of care. So what I would submit to Joanne Lamont, that this government's decision to have a national health service, a properly integrated national health service, instead of having one which is internally competing on the road to privatisation, started by the Labour Party south of the border, is vindicated by events both in Scotland and in England.
Joanne Lamont.
The First Minister accuses me of making a political point and then goes on precisely to do that in defence complacently of what is happening in the National Health Service now. All I ask him is to understand the people of this country are not talking about constitutional platforms. They want a First Minister who will address the needs of women like Anne Fisher now.
First Minister.
I think the fact that in the House of Commons I voted against foundation hospitals and the Labour Party voted for them is something that's worthy of political debate. Now, Joanne Lamont says that she doesn't like constitutional politics and she worries that the SNP's attention is devoted to constitutional politics. I've been doing a bit of analysis. I've been analysing the questions that Joanne Lamont has asked me. What is the number one subject that Joanne Lamont asked me about at First Minister's Question? Is it the economy? Is it the health service? Is it education? No, it's Scottish independence. So the woman who accuses this government of being obsessed by independence comes along here and invariably asks about Scottish independence. The reason she asks about Scottish independence is because the Labour record and everything else is so lamentable. The reason I enjoy her asking about Scottish independence is it's by accessing the resources, human and material, of this nation that we can put not just the public services but the economy of this country to rights.
Question number two, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister when he'll next meet the Prime Minister.
Minister?
No plans, near future.
Ruth Davidson?
On college funding, MPD failures and a cancer drugs fund, I'm not sure if Joanne Lamont's just gone through the Scottish Conservative greatest hits, but I'd quite like to take the First Minister through some of his own pet projects. First of all, the Rural Parliament for Scotland, which was announced in September 2011 and 17 months on, has not been established. The Scottish Sentencing Council legislation passed in June 2010, 2 years and 8 months on, not established. The College Reform Programme, announced in September 2011, with some measures having no timescale at all. This from a First Minister who says he can build an entire independent nation in just 18 months. The constitutional expert, Professor Adam Tomkins, says that that timetable is, and I quote, not just unrealistic, but hopelessly unrealistic. On the basis of his own failings, why is the First Minister right, but the acknowledged expert in this field wrong?
First Minister?
As far as the greatest hits for the Conservative and Labour Party being one and the same, that's all part of the Better Together campaign, presumably. As far as the college reorganisation, I thought the basis of many Conservative MSPs, at least, is we were proceeding too fast with college reorganisation. But, of course, the reorganisation is an essential part of the future of Scotland's colleges. I was struck yesterday in the college debate by two things. Firstly, that Mr Swinney has managed to devote to Scotland colleges the highest revenue figure, higher than any figure in the entire Labour-Liberal coalition. Of 522 million, their highest was 510 million. Well, I'm glad that the Tory benches asked about real terms. You see, I've been casting my eyes south as to what the position, as we understand it,
order.
In England is in terms of the college funding position, and it appears that the cut that is coming, it's not 4%, but it's nearer 20% in terms of the comparable budget. And given that Scotland's finances, as the Conservative Party know and have drawn a line in the sand, are directly dependent on Barnett consequentials, Isn't it a triumph that we've managed to avoid the near 20% cut in college funding that their colleagues are inflicting with Liberal Democrat support south of the border? And in terms of the timetable on independence, you know, if 30 countries across the world managed to progress to independence from the referendum to independence quicker than that timetable, then I really do think the Conservative Party should ask them, why on earth shouldn't Scotland manage to do that as well? The reality is that whatever timetable the SNP laid out, however many international examples, the Conservative Party, mired in their negativity, would also always say, no, you can't. Well, yes, we can.
Ruth Davidson. Order, Mr. Davidson.
Despite the bulging-eyed bluster, the only thing that happened yesterday was that Mr. Swinney cut college funding by more than £24 million while his backbenchers clapped and cheered while he was doing it. Presiding Officer, quite apart from a welfare state, a Scottish Treasury, a Scottish Supreme Court, let's focus on just one body that this First Minister needs to establish in that 18-month timeframe, the armed forces, because the defence of the realm is the first responsibility of any government. There are...
We will hear Ms. Davidson, Mr. Stevenson, Mr. Stevenson, enough! Ms. Davidson.
There are 65,000 MOD civil servants supporting the UK military right now, but the Scottish Conservatives have learned that the number of people the Scottish Government has planning for a Scottish Defence Force is just seven. That's seven people who are not only facing an impossible task, but who were better deployed delivering the public services for which this Parliament is responsible. In fact, defence is just one of 16 areas where officials are being diverted from their devolved duties to work on the First Minister's separatist obsession. So it is
Just settle down, please.
It is no wonder that this First Minister can't create a rural parliament or a Scottish sentencing council or the college merger programme getting through in time. So will the First Minister admit that he's failing to run a devolved nation, never mind planning a new one?
First Minister?
I was waiting for the climax. But, well, can I just restate again? Because if the average time period for the 30 countries that were listed in 15 months, and I find it very difficult to understand why Scotland and the UK as developed democracies couldn't achieve a similar or actually slightly greater time period. That seems an entirely reasonable point. Actually, for the four European countries in that list, the average time period seems to be 4 months. So I would think that being in that position is pretty well established by international comparisons. Can I turn to, I don't know if the defence industry and the troops, the ones who have been made compulsory redundant.
Yes.
You know, the ones who are fighting for the country and then are being handed a P-45 by this Tory Liberal government, I don't actually think that's the Conservative Party's strongest suit at the present moment. And I thought the complaint of the Conservative Party was there was too many people in the Scottish Government planning for independence. Yes. Now we seem to be suggesting there's too few. And all these thousands of folk... These thousands of folk in the Ministry of Defence that Ruth Davidson quotes in aid, these are the thousands of planners, the ones who planned to have aircraft carriers and then forgot to have the aircraft to put on them. Are these really the sort of examples that Ruth Davidson... Well, I see you've noted down, that's the point. Yeah, great aircraft carriers, no planes to put on them. It's not the most fantastic idea of Ministry of Defence planning. They used to say military intelligence was an oxymoron. I think MOD planning is the real oxymoron.
Question number three, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Issues of importance to the people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
Yesterday in the budget, I was told that my, I think, realistic and costly proposals to give 24,000 two-year-olds a free nursery place had been rejected by the government. I was told that the First Minister's government preferred family nurse partnerships instead. Can he tell me how many children currently benefit from family nurse partnerships?
First Minister.
Well, it's a low figure at the present moment, which is exactly why it's being rolled out across Scotland. As we announced last October, the pilot was in Lothian and is now being rolled out across Scotland. But can I say to Willie Rennie that his argument was carefully considered. And the reason the government's taking the stance it has is twofold. One, we believe we should get to the 600 hours. Can I remind them we inherited 412.5 hours, I think, and make that apply to 3- and 4-year-olds and give it statutory backing. Our partners and councils say that we can achieve this in the high quality standards that Scotland is used to in terms of childcare and nursery provision, which are much higher, as you should know, than in England and Wales at the present moment in terms of the qualifications that staff have to have. And secondly, there is a strong belief in England at the present moment expressed by many local authorities that the only way the Conservative Liberal coalition are going to extend to 2-year-olds is by reducing the standards. Well, yes, shake your head. It's only a week since it was announced there would be a relaxation of the number of children per worker. Now, I think there is a case to be made in terms of the quality of provision as well as the incredible extension to 600 hours. And many, many families across Scotland will welcome that increasingly.
Yeah. Will there any?
I suspect even the most sycophantic backbencher will have recognised that my question was about family nurse partnerships, not 3- and 4-year-olds. And he should also recognise, he should check his facts. If he looks at what's happening in England, they are increasing the standard for nursery education, not reducing it. He should check his facts. And he's right, it is a low number. It's only 908. Now, family nurse partnerships, they are a good thing, but they're no substitute for 24,000 nursery places. They're doing both in England. It's not one or the other, they're doing both. I shouldn't have to remind them, but the investment before the age of 3, all the experts say, is the best investment to make. It gives the best return. So if he's not going to use his budget to make this change, how is he going to close the gap between the 900 people that he wants to help and the 24,000 people that could benefit under my plans?
First Minister.
As I pointed out, the family nurse partnerships have been rolled out across Scotland. That was the purpose of the October announcement, because of their success in the pilot study. Now, I hope that Willie Rennie is going to go back and revise his question in terms of the record, because he said that standards were being increased, and perhaps he was referring to the qualifications of the staff in England. But that's not the point I made to him. The point I made to him was the relaxation in terms of the number of children per staff member. Now, if you increase the number of children allowed per staff member, that would tend to me to indicate a lowering of quality of provision as opposed... Well, there is substantial... And yes, it is going up, and not the greater number of children per staff member. That would indicate to me a lowering of quality of provision, as many people. And we're very happy to debate with Willie Rennie about how the best way forward. But I do think that the extension to 600 hours, the initiative's been taken, the early years development are a very substantial part of this government's programme and the stress on early years. But, you know, Willie Rennie... This is an argument he puts forward and an argument I hope that we listen to and respond to in terms of the early years planning. But he represents or is in a party in government which is destroying the livelihoods of low-income families across Scotland at the present moment. They've lost hundreds, if thousands of pounds in terms of tax allowances and childcare and now face the prospect of being forcibly, in terms of finance, evicted from their homes if they happen to have a spare room. So, representing a party which is engaged in that sort of policy, it is a bit of a brass neck to come along here and pretend you're on the side of young families.
Question number 4, Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the impact will be on Scotland's fishing fleet of Iceland's proposed 15% reduction in its mackerel quota.
First Minister.
The Iceland's declaration of what is another large unilateral quota is disappointing. It should be said they've reduced the quota by 15%, but they continue to take 22% of the total allowable catch, a share well in excess of their claim to 15% of the fishery, which is in itself too high given a very short time period of participation in that fishery. Now, that is unsustainable behaviour, and it's putting at risk Scotland's most valuable fishery, and of course that in turn puts at risk the jobs which are important to vulnerable coastal communities.
Rob Gibson.
I thank the First Minister for his answer. I wonder if it's possible for action to be taken to set up a mediation process to bring Iceland into the overall stock management arrangements for mackerel in the North East Atlantic.
First Minister.
Well, the current process has involved 15 rounds over 4 years of negotiation and clearly hasn't worked. And I think, therefore, the Cabinet Secretary is right to call for a new approach. And that's why Richard Lockhead has put forward the idea of an international mediator, an independent, respected person who can help bring the parties together and facilitate an agreement. We are liaising with the European Commissioner and other mackerel fishing countries to take forward this notion. But I know that the Chamber will appreciate the seriousness of this situation, and I hope we have unanimous support for Richard Lockhead's initiative.
Tavish Scott.
Does that last answer mean that the First Minister and his government have turned their back on the EU sanctions that were previously agreed by the European Commission? And does he also recognise that whitefish boats, not just from the north-east of Scotland but also from Shetland, are now stopped fishing in Faroese waters because that government has unilaterally taken that action as well?
First Minister.
No, it doesn't. I mean, we pressed for the sanctions as a means of getting people back to the table, but Tavish Scott must accept that we must find a new approach. We had the 15 round of negotiations over 4 years. Neither the fishermen that he currently represents or the ones that I used to represent are in any doubt that this situation cannot be allowed to drag on. So we've supported strongly the enforcement of sanctions, in which the European Union has been dragging its feet. But we also support a new initiative to try and bring the parties back to the table. And the idea of international mediation, I think, is a new idea in the context, and I think it's going to get a broad welcome from the people who realise how important it is for us to make a breakthrough now.
Question number five, Lewis MacDonald.
To ask the First Minister who will administer any fund established from the proceeds of a victim surcharge on offenders.
First Minister.
Well, it's a very important proposal in the Victim and Witnesses Scotland Bill, which was published today. It will help raise funds to be used in supporting those affected by crime. Now, the detail was set through subordinate legislation, but our first choice as an administrator of the Victim Surcharge Fund is Victim Support Scotland, working in collaboration with other national victim support organisations.
Lewis MacDonald.
I thank the First Minister, and of course a Victims Fund is a splendid idea to be welcomed. The issue, of course, as ever, is how it is to be implemented. Has the First Minister read the Government's policy memorandum published today as part of the bill, which says that the Scottish Court Service expects fully one-third of court fines to remain unpaid 12 months after they've been imposed? Over half of fiscal fines imposed in the last 3 years are not yet paid in full. How will the victim surcharge be any different?
First Minister.
Well, let me welcome the welcome for this initiative, and the member is absolutely right. This is exactly why we have legislation, we have proposals as they've been discussed in Parliament, and get to the best possible position in securing the success of the Victim Support Fund. But now that we've agreed on the principle, perhaps Lewis MacDonald and Kenny McCaskill can also agree on the practicality.
Very briefly, Ms Graham.
The Victims and Witnesses Bill will come, of course, to the Justice Committee, and I note there is a separate, distinct police restitution orders. How will these work?
First Minister.
The offences against police officers, of course, are unacceptable, and we propose in the Victim Witnesses Bill to create a new kind of penalty, the restitution order, whereby those who are found guilty of assaults on the police are required to contribute to treatment and rehabilitation services for police officers. Restitution orders are not intended to replace existing compensation orders to individual police officers.
Question number six, Aileen MacLeod.
To ask the First Minister what progress the Scottish Government has made on tackling hospital-acquired infections.
First Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government established the Healthcare Environment Inspectorate in 2009 to help reduce healthcare-acquired infections and the risk to patients through a rigorous inspection framework. The Inspector's annual report was published earlier this week. It highlighted that between October 2011 and September 2012, there was a 42.7% reduction in the number of cases of C. diff and a 52.2% reduction in the number of cases of MRSA compared to when the inspector was first established in 2009-10.
Eileen MacLeod.
Can I thank the First Minister for his reply, and certainly the progress in the last year is very welcome. The First Minister may recall that in January of last year, Jackie Bailey claimed that Scotland was the supposed superbug capital of Europe, but failed to notice that her statistic related to 2005-06 when Labour were in office. So could the First Minister tell me what progress has been made since 2005-06 in reducing MRSA?
First Minister.
Well, from October 2005 to September 2006, there were 1,002 cases of MRSA. From October 2011 to December 2012, there were 185 cases. That's an 81.5% reduction in cases. And of course, Aileen McLeod is absolutely right. Jackie Bailey did issue a press release saying that Scotland was the superbug capital of Europe. No doubt unaware that the statistic referred to 2005-2006 when the Labour Party were in office. Now we have this dramatic reduction, and listen, 81.5% reduction is incredible, but it's not the full extent of what we're trying to do in this, but it is a very substantial progress. No doubt in some case, Jackie Bailey will accept that her epithet of the superbug capital of Europe, which I don't know if was the wisest thing she said anyway, applied to her party's administration of the National Health Service. Thank goodness the administration and the government has changed.
Jackson Carlo.
Can I wholeheartedly applaud the success of the government and the focus it's brought to this issue, both the current Cabinet Secretary and his predecessor, and congratulate all those in the NHS who have made the progress they have? We can't afford to be complacent. The First Minister, I wonder if he will respond to the following that I received this morning. As a nurse, I was rather disgusted to see the Scottish Health Minister park his backside in a patient's bed while opening a new hospital and wittering on about infection control. Can I implore the First Minister to encourage his colleagues to desist?
First Minister?
Well, it's absolutely true that one of the successes has been to instil changed behaviour on the part of patients, visitors, staff through the National Health Service, and that includes government ministers. And in future, every single one of us will aspire to the high standards of Jackson Carlo.
Sarah Boyack, briefly.
Given the concerns that recent public health officials in Lothian about unexplained rise in HAIs, what discussions has his government had with those officials in NHS Lothian, and what assurances can he give that the heat target will actually be met?
First Minister.
Well, one of the reasons that hospital-acquired infections are falling so fast in Scotland is this is an ongoing process. It's a part and parcel integrated into the health service. I know that people will have noticed that in response to the serious situation in health in the Mid Staffordshire, that the Prime Minister called in a former advisor to President Obama. It was actually that person who, looking at the health improvement and safety initiatives being made for the health service in Scotland, gave them the highest praise and said they were world leading. It does indicate that there can be, even in an area where substantial progress has been made, no complacency in terms of how the situation is developing. But in order to make sure we continue to make improvements, it has to be an ongoing process, and that is what's been done with hospital-acquired infections.
That ends First Minister's questions. We move to members' business, but I will allow a short pause to allow members to leave the chamber.